I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Oh, thank you everybody for coming out on this wonderful evening. Public hearing on proposed expenditures for invasive species expendable trust. Lydia.
Linda
Shire, come on up.
All right.
From the AWA.
Should I just
come on? Sure.
Nice to meet you, Ben. We haven't actually met before. As director of the Patchogue Wakefield Watersheds, I just sort of helped smooth this one along because there's four associations that run the Lake Coast program, which, you know, we all, I think, understand is the best defense we have against invasive species infestations. And as you're going to hear shortly, it's a whole lot easier to prevent it than it is to try to control it. So, everybody was asking for level funding from last year. Grady's Lake, $4,375. Level Lake, $3,875. Pine River Pond, $3,000. Province Lake, $3,375. And those are matched by an awful lot of Lake Association dollars. There used to be a special donor to the New Hampshire Lakes Association that gave a bigger amount to Wakefield to be distributed, and that didn't happen this year, so all the Wakefield Lake Associations go back to the standard one, which is considerably less than what they were getting, so their actual input is a lot, way more than 50%. So I don't know if you guys have questions. You know, Lovell Lake is right around 1,000 inspections a year. Great East is well over 2,000 inspections a year. Pine River and Province are a little less. Everybody's expanding their hours as much as they can to get as much coverage and using volunteers as much as they can. So we thank the town for all its support because we know you guys understand how important the lakes are to your area.
Is Great East Lake, does Maine do?
Yes.
Their pond?
Yep. Yep. They get a grant from the, it goes through, well, it's DEP money. It's called the Courtesy Boat Inspection Program there.
Ooh,
and so it's a similar amount.
Good.
So, yes, they do. And they also, they collect the data for both states there, so they, you know, that information goes to both states.
Yeah, good.
So, do you guys have any other questions?
Any questions for Linda?
No.
Motion to accept the $14,625 for the Lake Coast program, $4,375 going to Grady's Lake, $3,875 going to Lovell Lake, $3,000 to Pine River Pond, and $3,375 going to Province Lake.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Right. Who's representing Bellow Lake?
Aye.
Come on up.
Thank you. My name is Victor Vinagro, and I represent the Bellow Lake Property Owners Association. I'm the milfoil director and also a diver for the lake. We'd also like to welcome Vin to the board. On behalf of Bellow Lake, and I'd just like to give a little bit of background on our situation at Bellow Lake. Bellow Lake was a man-made lake. We do not have any public access, therefore the state doesn't recognize us for funding. Lino and I last year went to the state, went to Amy Spangler of DES, referred us to Tom O'Brien of the Lake Management Program. Catch 22. Either permits and abide by the rules, but we don't get any funding. So I came to this program 9 years ago. My wife and I both are divers for the program, we're certified through DES to harvest the milk for it. When we first came, we were impressed at all the volunteers for the lake. Everything is done on volunteer. They have made a harvester, which is a pontoon boat that we use to remove the milfoil. It was put together, all the materials were donated, all the labor to build it was donated. We've also purchased an air compressor. We fill our own air tanks. All the divers, the tenders are volunteers. $54 are allocated out of our dues that go to our milfoil program. So we are able to take care of it, and occasionally in the last few years we've had to do a treatment. So we've had a contract in place now with Solitude Lake Management Program to potentially treat twice this year. We are noticing some outbursts, and we think we're going to have to treat. We won't know until we get into the water. So that's why we're asking for $10,000. And part of the reason is, you know, we don't get the support. And the treatments programs are very expensive. I mean, right now we're currently carrying one for $38,000. We need to treat at the maximum. That's 100 acres in the summer and an additional 50 acres in the fall or late summer. So we thank the town of Wakefield for the past donations, and we'd like to have the funds released.
And so if you had, it's because you don't have public access, is the reason why the state doesn't.
And also the fact that it was man-made. The lake was was five ponds, was flooded out,
gotcha.
And you know, I guess they didn't go through the proper permitting process or whatever, but this is where we are now.
Yeah. So we saw it last night.
We good to go on voting for this? Motion to accept the $10,000 as presented in Article 15.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you for all the work you do.
Thank you very much.
You've got an uphill battle up there.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I think Charlie would say wait, you're waiting for Pilgrim to go launch it.
Thank you very much.
Go on.
Thank you.
Sue Jackman from Paul's Lake.
Okay, now don't laugh.
Okay.
My name isn't Sue.
What name is Sue?
I thought you were retired.
Well, I was. I'm going to explain why I'm here again. Yeah, my name is Don Pierce, and I'm past president for the last 5 years of Walsh Lake Improvement Association. And our incoming president, Sue, is trying to sell a house in South Carolina. So here I am. And before I get started, I'd like to thank the folks in Bellow Lake for giving us all of the milfoil that we have on our lake. But in any case, you know, we treat both chemically and with our dashboard operations. And a number that I think will certainly impress you is last year, we pulled, besides our chemical treatment, we pulled 15,000 pounds of milfoil out of Bulge with our divers.
Wow.
It's the largest amount that we've ever pulled. The next largest amount was 11,000 3 years ago. There's reasons for that. I mean, weather has a lot to do with ice, so forth and so on, but it was a big year last year. So relative to this year, New Hampshire DES has been in to the lake, and they have identified more than 30 acres that they say are eligible for chemical treatments. Now, we won't do 30 acres for two reasons. One is the economics of it all. Mm-hmm. And the other is there are areas that are identified, and this happens every year, this mm-hmm. is not unusual, that are much better for our divers in the water. But by the end of the day tomorrow, we will have reached an agreement with DES and then their vendor to agree on the number of acres, you know, to be treated. We've started diving last Wednesday. We'll continue to dive right through the end of June, and then we share our dive team with Lake Arrowhead. Mm-hmm. And so they'll be July, August, and Arrowhead, and then they'll be back here at Falls from Labor Day weekend right through the Columbus Day weekend. And so it's like cutting grass. Mm-hmm. You know, it just doesn't go away. There's no technology available. There's no method, particularly in a lake bottom like Balch has. Some lake bottoms that are more sandy or rocky bottom, it's possible to get close to eradication, but not in our case. So it's something like mowing grass every year.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. I see. Yeah.
Great. And who is the vendor that DES is
running? Same as.
Okay.
It's the only one in New England, by the way.
Solitude Lake Management.
Right. Okay, I kind of thought that rang a bell. Great. You want to make that motion?
I make the motion that we accept Balch Lake request.
For $7,500.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Keep up the good work up there.
Yeah, one last note. You know, this town has been a leader, and I think Linda will agree with me. Wakefield has been taken a real leadership position in this invasive species. I mean, it works good for us and it works good for you. It keeps property values and so forth. But you've put the time, the energy, and you've put the money into it. And I want you to know that all people on Balch really appreciate your support.
Thank you. Public input.
Yeah, public comment, you said?
No public input for this public hearing. Seeing none, I close the public hearing for the capital expenditures. We have no appointments, we just have them.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Wait a second, everybody can leave.
Welcome
to stay.
We'll be quick.
Yeah. How are you?
Good.
Well, glad to have you. How are you?
I'm nervous
because.
Are you?
Good. Get up and when you're sleeping.
Yep.
You have to really trust the
order. Right.
We're all going to sit on the chair.
Who's coming in? Who's going out? Great. Public comment.
I've noticed the last three or four meetings, you gentlemen can't make it here at 7 o'clock. You posted it at 7. If you're going to have your dance meeting,
non-public,
have it afterwards. I mean, it's kind of not being respectful, I think.
Okay, we'll work on that, John. Any other public comment?
On what issue?
It would be public comment one, so it would be agenda items. Good, Ralph?
I'm never good, but okay. I'm okay.
Okay. Unfinished business, public participation at select board's meetings. We have a draft. I wanted to wait for Connie's input on this before we passed it.
Can you read it for the public?
It's quite a bit, Ralph. Do you want to read it?
Later.
Okay.
Will it be posted on the website?
Yep.
Second?
If you have a second discussion?
Yeah, I guess I would like to say that I know we have two sections of public comment, But it almost seems like it would be more beneficial to have public comment if anybody needed to say anything during the topic.
That way we ain't gonna get out social media.
Like if we had something on the agenda and we talked about it, we voted on it, then we could have anybody have any that they want to say about that agenda topic. You could restrict it, but instead of waiting down to the, I guess, to me it just would make sense.
Well, actually they have the first one would be before we vote on any matters, would be after the appointments, before we vote on anything, they have this time to speak on the agenda items before we vote.
Right.
So we would hear the input beforehand, and then we would do our business and then hear at the end. Is there anything you want to change in it? Because it protects us and also protects the public.
Right.
On public comment two, they can discuss anything
right.
that we voted on.
And right? anything else?
Yes.
So if they want to come in and tell us, dark out.
Well, this is what I'm saying is, say that these people that came in here for this mm-hmm. wanted to say something about it, but didn't want to wait to the last. People that came in for the first thing on the agenda.
Public hearing?
Public hearing?
Not for that. Any agenda.
Well, it usually goes by appointments and then it goes unscheduled matter, public comment okay. one, before we get into our business.
All I was saying was each topic, after we have a vote, we have, if the public wanted to have any input on each topic
sure.
at that point, not waiting to the end.
No, they have the opportunity in the beginning to talk about the agenda items.
But they don't know what's going to be discussed. That we discuss until, if they want to discuss it beforehand, they really don't have anything they can add to it if we go after them, is what I'm saying.
Maybe I'm being unclear. Part three would be unscheduled matters, public comment for agenda items, before we get into our agenda items.
All right.
So we would have our appointments, we would talk to whoever was coming in for an appointment, which last meeting was the gentleman from Mr. McGowan, and then we had public comment and then we went into our agenda items. So people can feel free to talk to us about the agenda items coming up. And then at the end,
okay.
anything else. So I just want to make sure that we're clear on the public talking.
Okay.
Because I'm strong on that to make sure we have public participation. Any further discussion? Connie, your ideas, anything you want to change?
No.
You like it?
It's good, yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye?
Aye.
All opposed? Passes unanimously. Okay.
Excuse me.
WWTF septic pumping proposals.
She left the matter dash sheets.
Happy birthday, Tom, a day late.
And a dollar, sure. Yeah, thank you. It's easier as you get older, right, John? It seems to slide down. Oh,
yeah, that's great. Right.
Unopened.
From Lakes Region Septic, pumping an off-site disposal of wastewater sludge from the town of Dunes to be priced at $17.50 per gallon plus cost of lab analysis. This priced according to disposal fee at the time of 8 cents a gallon. This is the disposal rate to date. If disposal rate changes and takes place, disposal will be priced accordingly. Lakes Region Septic Service is licensed with the state of New Hampshire, fully insured. Please advise us as soon as possible if we are awarded the bid so we can schedule the work for you. South Berwick Wastewater Treatment Plant requires lab analysis of volatile organics from the town lagoons before disposal of the waste. The town has a regular lab analysis testing company. The cost may be lesser to you. Signed, John Lamb, Lakes Region Septic. $17.50.
$17.05?
Yes.
Yeah.
Is it 17 cents a gallon?
$17.50 a gallon. 17.5 cents per gallon.
Okay. Cents. Sure.
Cents.
Cents.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
$17.50.
What's
the other one? Oh, 17.5 cents per gallon.
Okay.
Okay, I see what you mean now.
Because is there two dots in that? In
I don't think I had enough water today.
Right. I think that's what it is. It's been a long day for all of us.
Yeah.
This one is from VH Cameron. They are at 20 cents per gallon. This does not have a caveat for testing.
So we
propose to pump it.
Include the testing? Because our bid specifically said that the lab testing was to be included. So if the 20 cents includes the lab testing, point of order, that one does not meet our requirement.
We propose to pump approximately 20,000 gallons of sludge at 20 cents a gallon. This is based on pumping, removing, and dumping off-site 3 times per year. All work to be completed in a workmanlike manner according to standard practices. Work carries workman's comp to 45 employees. The above price to specification and conditions are satisfactory and are hereby accepted. You are authorized to do it. We haven't done that yet. If you just want to review those real quick to make sure we got it right. With that, they're apples to apples.
It does say South Berwick Wastewater Treatment Plant requires lab analysis, but it doesn't say that there's any extra cost to that. Well, yeah, up here it does say 17.5 cents per gallon plus the cost of lab analysis.
Mm-hmm.
This one doesn't say that.
Right.
Right. But it doesn't say how much the cost is.
And the way the public notice reads is bids should be quoted a guaranteed per gallon cost, no variable rates. All costs for necessary lab analysis must be included in the bid.
Do we have an idea of what the lab analysis cost us? They have it now, right? Do they have the contract now?
We haven't done any since last year, and I don't remember off the top of my head what the lab analysis was. I think we need to move forward with this because we should be having this stuff disposed of. I would say that the best thing you could probably do is make a motion that if the 20 cents per gallon includes the lab test, that you go with that because they included it the way the quote said. If they're both wrong, you can either deny them both and rebid it or go with the 17.5 cents because it's less.
You want any clarification from Cameron on whether it includes lab testing or not?
I don't want to wait another 3 weeks
to have you guys approve it. We can give you the authorization to approve it if it includes lab testing.
Yeah, I mean, if that's what I think the motion has to be, is that if Cameron includes the lab testing as specified in the public notice, then we go with them. If not, then they're both have an issue with them because they didn't include the lab testing and we go with the lesser.
I mean, we have a local, they're a local business. You know, it goes a little bit further than just saying the bottom line. I mean, you get a local business that donates to a lot of things in town.
Uh-huh.
They are proactive. And from what I know, we don't have to go with the lowest bidder, right? It has to be. Is it, or do we? Mm-hmm. I'm just saying that we have to take in consideration everything that they do for the town as well.
Cameron or Lakes
Region.
Region.
They do a lot for the town. They sponsor teams. They, I just think that we.
But if they didn't do the bid properly and Cameron did, then you just have to deny them both and rebid it. You can't. I mean, if you specifically wrote this like this and they didn't even adhere to the bid document, if they both didn't adhere, then you have the same problem with both. But if one of them did it the way you asked, that's why his is more, and you don't even know how much more.
applicant. Just get clarification from cameras if he included the testing or if it was an oversight, if there's an additional cost for testing.
Okay, and bring that back to you in 3 weeks?
2 weeks.
3 weeks. We have an extra week. We're not meeting until the 13th. And we haven't taken anything out of there yet this year. This is our second shot.
I would say I would like to just make the motion that we accept Lakes Region.
I'll second it for discussion.
The problem with accepting is it wasn't.
The bid is faulty.
It wasn't a bid to the specifications in the RFP.
Okay.
We'd be setting a precedent for not following what we set out in our policies and procedures.
Just sure how many times we bid on this that.
It's actually the second time.
Only the second time he's been on it?
No, second time.
No, I get that, but maybe there's some confusion on, maybe it isn't the same as it has been in the past as far as, because.
I believe we went through the same thing last summer, didn't we? Cameron was, but I believe Cameron was last.
That was the septic over at the, that was the septic issue over at the.
Wakefield Resource Center.
Yes, the Resource Center.
I think it was this one too, wasn't it?
The pumping he got last year.
Okay.
So, if we could just make sure that either one can include the cost. I mean, neither one of them follow the requirements in the RFP.
That's what I'm saying. If they both didn't follow it, then you can choose whichever you want. But if one didn't follow it and one did, then really, you should just stop putting stuff out to bid if you're not going to adhere to your own bid documents.
Right.
So, but now that he could say he's seen this and knows that if he says yes, he could get it.
As long as it's included in his cost sheet, if maybe he forgot to put it in there. But they've both seen the last meeting when we opened them up, and it was the same problem.
Yep.
So are you going to make a motion to go with Cameron?
There's a motion on the table that has to be voted on.
You're right, Ro.
You wish to withdraw your second and your first? Do you want to take a vote?
I'll withdraw my second.
Okay, I'll withdraw the motion. Okay.
The motion is to get clarification from vendors on testing and to award the vendor that has completed the RFP process correctly.
Second.
Further discussion?
And if neither of them completed a second, then you're going to go with the, the lesser, or you're going to go out again?
We'll go out again until people get it right. Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any new business?
Yes, there's two appointments before the board that we didn't have on Friday. So, the zoning board met on Monday night, and they have nominated Annie Robbins to be moved up from an alternate member to a full member, and they have made a nomination to make Robert Baxter an alternate member of the zoning board.
So I'll make a motion to accept. We should do them one each person, right?
Yes.
Annie Robbins as a zoning board member.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
How about that? Bye, Sean.
I make a motion to accept Robert Baxter as an alternate zoning board of adjustment.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Reserve fund, police vehicle, $7,692. They approved the purchase order but did not do the expenditure form.
So this is, we've still got 29,000 in there?
Well, I guess what happened was they didn't get a form put in.
Oh, you really probably only have $730 in there because you've already approved the purchase orders and the checks have been cut. This form was omitted.
Usually
capital reserve expenditures are always on the agenda.
Okay.
We didn't have this form, so we're just kind of catching up.
Okay. Thank you. Oh, yeah, I see. Yep.
Do we need a motion to accept this? Or is this just follow up paperwork on that motion? Motion to accept the capital reserve fund expenditure for $7,692.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 One more for
you go.
My apologies. $28,916 for the purchase of the Ford Interceptor.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We have correspondence. Mr. Mankus. Mr. Mankus has resigned from the Conservation Committee as a full member. Motion to accept the resignation with regret and thank him for his service to his immeasurable service to the town, because I know he's involved in lots of things.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Public comment 2.
What road do we plan on grading? Paving? Issue?
I think mine are fine, is it?
Yeah.
The roads we're going to pay.
I think plenty of the poems up.
Is the Pine River Pond?
Yes. And yeah. Some there's part,
the road
that
goes
there's
up.
A little bit of another road too. I can't remember which one.
No. We'll find out for you, John.
What is it?
We'll find out for you.
Great.
I think it's probably Slate Lake Road and Side Road.
Well, I thought it might be, but I want to be sure, but I was going to call F.R. Carroll to let him know about it, but I thought it was going to be Ballinger's and Pine River Road, but I could be wrong.
We'll get clarification. Anyone else? Ralph?
Is the letter of resignation from the Conservation Commission part of the official record?
It is open? Now.
It will be open? Or
do you want me to read it to you?
Sure, if you'd like. It may lead to another public comment.
There's an old saying that if you're a member of a rural volunteer fire department, you can only leave if you bring in your replacement. We have had two new people come on the Conservation Committee as alternates, which gives me the opportunity to resign without leaving the commission short a member. Due to the demands of my business, I do wish to resign at this time. Respectfully, Mr. Mankus.
I would also like to thank him for his service on the Conservation Commission.
So noted. Anyone else? That's good. We've got that. Town administrator's update.
We have some ambulance bills to write off. There are 8 to write off. They've gotten 2 letters from the company, 2 letters from me, no response, and there is no social security number. And then there are 3 that I would like to send to Experian. Those also had 2 letters from the company, 2 letters from me, and we do have social security numbers. This is what I'm asking without the names.
Thank you. You want to do that, Bob?
The whole amount to write off is $7,338.91, and the amount being asked to send to Experian is $1,412.21.
Yep. That's for Experian. Oh.
And the total on the last, the total past due on the last disposition report was $26,540.24. So this would bring it down to about $16,000.
How are we doing on collections? Have they gone up since we tried to do more of a?
I think we're doing better at getting social security numbers, so we're doing better at getting some response from people. We've had a few people come in and pay. We've had some partial payments, and we've had more letters referring to hardships and explaining and asking for a hardship abatement of their bill.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your work on these two. Easy to keep track of these. Motion to dispose of $7,338.91.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Motion to send to Experian $1,012.21.
Second.
Any discussion?
I thought it was 14. 14.12. Yeah. 14.12.21.
Yeah.
Nope.
All in favor?
Aye.
So the next item I have, it was brought to my attention recently that our emergency operations plan expires in 2018. Without a current emergency operations plan for the town, we would be unable to apply for any FEMA disaster money that became available until we could have a rewrite of our plan done. If we wait until next year, it'll be probably summer, fall of 19. That means we would go an entire winter without being able to recoup the 75% funding that FEMA makes available in a declared emergency. So I reached out to Homeland Security and Emergency Management and spoke to our representative there. There are EOP grant, the Emergency Operations Plan is called the LEOP, a Local Emergency Operations Plan. There are grants, they're 50-50 grants, but we can use the labor of the employees that participate as a soft match to the grant. Generally speaking, and I can't guarantee this, but generally speaking, there is no outlay of cost of cash to have these done. There are a few private companies that do them, and then usually the Regional Planning Commissions will help. I reached out to Stratford Regional Planning Commission, and they have not done one, and they don't have anybody certified to do one right now, but they are willing to get somebody certified, and they thought the cost would be about $5,000. I also reached out to June Garno from MAPS. She did your hazard mitigation plan. I believe she worked on it in 2016 with previous staff and then delivered it in 2017. She thought she could do it for about $4,500. And basically that amount would be doubled. The grant would be $9,000 or $10,000, and we would match it with our employee labor rate. I reached out to one more company because I thought it would be over $5,000, so I was trying to get 3 prices, but obviously one of them is under $5,000. I reached out to one more company that I have not heard back from that is a company that I've used in other towns. So I hope to have 3 prices. I basically like your permission to go ahead and complete the grant application and see if we can move that forward this summer. and try to at least get this started and get it done by the fall so that we don't miss out on any declared disasters.
And the grant would be the LEO grant?
LEOP grant, yeah.
And that's through Homeland, and they don't have anybody on staff that can help us write that?
No, they farm it out to private companies or to the regional planning commissions.
Do they have a preferred vendor list for that? That might do the grant writing for us to get the job.
The grant itself has got to be done online through their website. You can't even print an application anymore. I can't even look at it. I have to go on and do it while I'm doing it. So I think Heidi, our field rep, would help. Actually, this is the responsibility of your emergency management director, who happens to be your new police chief. So I'm happy to help him. I'm happy to apply for the grant if he doesn't think he can do it, but he will have to be actively involved in this. And so we have ESF's emergency support functions, different departments. The DPW has responsibilities on certain ones. I have responsibilities. The treasurer has responsibilities under the financial piece. There's requirements of different departments, so it will require some comprehensive meetings. And I anticipate that Homeland Security and Emergency Management field rep will be here for those meetings because they have a lot of input. There's a template for how these ESFs get written, and there's a matrix that you have to do for kinds of emergencies. And it's some of the work that was done for the hazard mitigation plan can be used, the matrices.
Matrices.
Can be used for the ELP, but some of it is all new things that will have to be done. So, different departments will have to participate. Police department, clearly, fire, highway, finance, welfare. There's a role for all of them to play. So, but I think it's important that we try to get this done ASAP, because I don't really want to have a lapse in our ability to qualify for any kind of disaster funding.
Motion to have Kelly fast-track the grant application for LEOP.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. How often do we need to do that?
Every 5 years, and I apologize for missing it during the budget process, because it really should have been gross budgeted, but Ken Fifield was the emergency management director and was on his way out. John is new. I had no idea it expired, so I will do better calendaring these and things so that we don't wind up in this situation, because this has been very labor intensive this summer.
Yeah, let's put that on capital improvements, at least the plan, so that way we know what's coming in 5 years.
Okay. The next thing is we have a written request from the treasurer in Brookfield. They've been cleaning out the town hall attic, and they have a CRT old computer monitor and two small flat screen monitors that they would like to bring into the transfer station free of charge. If they are actually small, depending on how many inches they are, the two small flat screens would be $4 each, and the CRT would be probably $8. So we're looking at $16 potentially. I think they approached Warren, and he told them, we don't have the authority to waive fees, only the Board of Selectmen can waive those.
Yeah, I would be hesitant to waive those for the precedent that we've set.
I agree. I think
probably cost them that much to make that letter.
I mean, we like, help out during the roadside cleanup and all that stuff. That's obviously a good benefit, but you start doing this and there's set a precedent, I think.
So, I do.
See that.
So, you're denied.
Motion to deny the request to waive the dump fees.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The next thing is we were provided with minutes of the Greater Wakefield Resource Center and their most current financial statements. Their next meeting is on June 8th, and the welfare director, Arlene Fogg, and I will be attending. They'll want to discuss the Meals on Wheels program with us. And then they also, if you look down almost at the bottom of the first page, there's some repairs and maintenance items that they're looking to do. The ones that are outside of our responsibility, I did not budget for the sidewalk. I can only budget for what they tell me about. I knew about door closers for the automatic door, the outside door, and we had a conversation that they would pay for the automatic closer for the door to the dining room. The elderly people are having trouble, you know, with the heavy doors. And then I had also budgeted money to gate a back stairway that's actually in the lawn that goes down to some parking, and to permanently gate that off, because if you walk through there, it's like a 4-foot drop onto a concrete wellhead. They are looking, it appears from these minutes, that they're looking to bring that up to code rather than fence it off, and I know I did not budget enough money to bring it up to code. It would all have to be dug out and properly, and I'm not sure that we even own the land back in the back of that, so it's kind of a gate to nowhere. I think people do park down there, but they want them to walk around, and so I think we have to look at that and see if that makes sense or not. Even if it does make sense, I would not have enough money to bring it up to code. I just didn't budget for that.
How much is it to gate it off?
I think I budgeted $800 to $1,000 for a permanent gate. We might be able to do something temporary for now so that it's not such a safety hazard, and then look to see if we can do something different in 2019. Do some kind of temporary barricade. I'm just petrified that somebody elderly is going to walk out there and pour light and take a 4-foot drop onto a concrete wellhead.
Okay, so can we get that put up right away so there's no issue, or do we need to go out to bid for this, or can we have the highway department go there with the fence?
I can talk to the highway department. I think they can put something up.
Even if it's just a temporary barricade.
And then, you know, some of this is inside stuff, some of it is maintenance stuff. I think the DPW department took care of the bittersweet and the poison ivy last year, and I would recommend that they do that again this year. If they want something more permanent done with it, you know, they have to let me know before the budget. I can't budget for stuff I don't know about. So I can see how far our budget will go. And then the window in the kitchen. I've already talked to the highway department about repairing the gutters there. I think they can do that work. And the tile in the kitchen and the pantry, that's an indoor thing. That's something they're responsible for. And again, the sidewalk, they would have to get a quote, and I can budget that for 2019. We'll see how far the $5,000 goes, but the quote for the doors were about $2,800 plus electrical, because they have to, you know, have a power. Yeah. Each one has to have a separate power supply. I think we need to do that first, then the gate, and then see what's left.
Well, we need to put something up so nobody falls off of that, so we don't have to, we can mitigate the liability.
Fall off of
wherever
that
backstop.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
So once I have a chance to, like I said, Arlene and I are going to their meeting on June 8th. I'll report back and let you know where we are. And I also asked them to please, we got the quotes on the automatic doors, I think summertime last year, so I asked them to please call the electrician, because Dame Electric had the best price, and update the quote so we make sure we know what we're dealing with. I think the whole quote was $39.75 for both doors, but they weren't an equal amount. The dining room door needed more stuff because of the potential for fire in the kitchen. It has to be linked to the...
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It needs to be magnetic relays.
Yeah. So as soon as I know exactly what we're into for that, I can tell you how much we have left and whether we can do some of this other stuff. But I think that DPW department can take care of the gutter for a pretty reasonable amount of money. And I think they can at least mitigate the bittersweet, the poison ivy for now. We'll see if we can do something more with them.
And then the walkway as well.
The door and the walkway are getting done first, for sure.
Great. Thank you.
Yep.
And is there a meeting at 9 a.m. or 9 p.m.?
9 a.m.
Yeah,
sorry. And you're their liaison if you want to come with us.
Yep.
On the 8th. No, you are.
I think I am.
Budget school.
Yeah.
The thing that's...
I want to talk to you about beer and wine.
Yeah, I don't know.
The thing that's posted in my office says it's Lena. Can you just verify the vote?
I guess.
My list says it's Lena. I checked yesterday, so... I have an MS-535 from our auditors. This is our financial report of the budget for 2017, even though it's dated 18. You guys need to sign it. Our unassigned fund balance, which will be available to us to use to reduce taxes when we set the tax rate in the fall, has gone down in 2018 from 1.988 million to 1.781 million. And that's just a factor of what we used last year. In 2018, we used $333,000 to do the public safety building. In 18, we used some to reduce the tax rate. So 1.781 million is a pretty healthy unassigned fund balance.
Does that include the truck reduction as well?
No.
So
this is 12/31/17.
Okay.
And I just need you guys to sign off on that so I can upload it to the DRA portal.
Was there a return from the public safety building to this fund?
I think there was. I think if you look at the next last page or the next to last page, I want to say it was 24,000 ish. 24, 64. Did you see him? So this was the unassigned fund balance. This is the unassigned fund balance. That was the 3-3, and looks like they returned 24,407.
What was the original take for that fund, that public safety building? Was it 400,000?
I think there was 67,000 from kept reserve fund and 333,000 from unassigned fund balance, so it was 400.
Thank you. And what is in the restricted fund balance that is not committed, it's restricted, so is it carry over from 17 for bills into 18, or is that?
I'd have to look at the definitions again, because there's committed, unassigned. They just changed that a couple years ago, what the definitions are. Suffice it to say, we can't spend the committed.
Well, it looks like
the
it's
restricted.
Not, there's three of them, non-spendable, restricted, and committed, and then
right.
We have assigned and then unassigned.
Yeah, and the only one that's available to us is the unassigned.
Only
in the front.
Glad you stopped me.
I'd make you a copy of it though if you want to.
Yeah,
I want,
that way I know what they're talking about.
Yeah, actually, can I get a copy of that too?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. There's new language in here from GASB, and I want to make sure that I'm up on it.
Yeah, because GASB 75 goes into effect next year.
Yep.
We're still currently under GASB 45, but I voluntarily implement 75 a year early because at the end of the day we got to do it anyway, and it isn't that much more money.
Motion to accept the 535 as presented by the town administrator.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any particular order, or just in position, or just sign it and then?
Yeah, just do it the way you usually do. That's fine.
Connie, you hit the top.
Yep.
You should have the top.
Jesus,
bless you.
Do your thing.
We have been experiencing difficulty with our current payroll company. We are having numerous mistakes made on our reporting for New Hampshire Retirement. They forgot to file Maine state taxes. We've had two, since I've been here for, in the year I've been here, we've had two late filings with the IRS. And I have tried to set up a meeting with the owner of the company, and he seems to decline my request. He will answer an email if I force the issue. I have been working closely with Michelle McDonald, who's our finance clerk. My first idea was to do it ourselves in-house, but that is a lot of work.
Yeah.
And if something happens to Michelle or she leaves, it's a lot of training, and we will have people cross-train. So I met with a payroll company, actually. Michelle and I both met with a payroll company, and I would like the board's permission to pursue a contract with a different company. The contract we have currently with CheckMate requires a 15-day written notice to leave. This company has a $500 setup fee, so it would be a little bit more this year than in other years, but they're going to guarantee the price for 3 years. CheckMate raises its price every year, so we don't even know what it'll be next year. And it would be under $5,000, so it wouldn't require the bid process. I don't really want to put it out to bid. I have used ADP, I have used Paychecks, now CheckMate. I'd really like to try this other company. Michelle would like to try this other company. And at the end of the day, we would save money. Paychecks, or CheckMate's total cost this year would have been over $7,000 because we were trying to implement electronic timesheeting. They charged us to figure that out for us, but it has never worked properly. We've been working on it since last July. And I would not go with the electronic timesheet with a new company, so it would be almost $3,000 cheaper at the end of the day, annually. That would be it'd be labor intensive for us to switch over, but once it was done, the argument I'm making now with Michelle, if she agrees, is that it's so complicated that it's hard to cross-train anybody else to do it. And also, the time she would spend moving it to a new company is time we won't spend correcting all these mistakes that we never know. Like, we just get these exception reports from New Hampshire Retirement. All our reporting is accurate. Their reporting is wrong. They never caught it. They pay the fine. If the IRS fines them, they pay it. But, you know, it's...
We don't need that.
No, and it kind of gives you this... If we ever did go back to doing our own payroll, we've got a bad reputation because it's on our federal ID number that CheckMates can never get our stuff right. I don't like to run afoul of Maine state taxes. We have an employee or two that live in Maine from time to time, so we have to report there. This company will do our 1094s and our 1095s, which Michelle is doing now, for less money than what CheckMate is charging us. They're very big in Massachusetts. They don't have any New Hampshire towns yet, but they're looking to get on the ground floor in New Hampshire town, and so I'm going to see if I can get them to waive the $500 setup fee, and I'll be their pilot. And if they do really well, then they'll have a municipality in the state that says, hey, they're great, give them a shot. Because I suspect there are other towns, and I've talked to at least one, that is not having really good luck with our current payroll company.
So, it's just the only vendor you contacted?
It is, because I've used ADP and Paychecks and had some of the same issues. I'd really like the opportunity to give these people a shot, and they'll guarantee the price for 3 years, which CheckMate is not doing.
No, I don't think any of them do that beyond 12 months.
They have,
Do you have any parcel yet?
I do have the proposal from them, and I have a brochure in my office. I didn't bring all that with me. I brought the it's it's got a little write-up about they've got an undisclosed off-site, hot site backup office. The hot site office is located in a second undisclosed area outside of Worcester that is accessible by major highway. Their electric power is generated by electric power supplemented by emergency generators. That's three times what they need to cut payroll. They have sleepover facilities and kitchens and showers in case their staff needs to stay in an emergency and do your payroll. They have the operational environment. Is a building constructed with 2 foot thick exterior walls and is surrounded by a 10 foot high barbed wire fence. Windows that face the front of the property are constructed with shed proof glass. They've really given thought to continuity of business, continuity of government for people that they're doing their payroll for. I'm kind of impressed. And they say, and I'm sure we heard the same story from CheckMate in 2011, but they say that, if anything goes wrong with payroll, if there's any problems, you can call your sales guy. He will get somebody on the phone. Right now, they might call me back. When I report that, I got a letter from the IRS. It took them 8 days to respond to me. 8 days to get an email back. Oh, yeah, we fixed that. I'm like, really? Well, that's awesome. When did you fix it, and why couldn't you call me?
And where's the confirmation you fixed it?
Oh, we get it in writing, because believe me, I don't.
Well, if they're trying to get into New Hampshire, maybe they go 4 years. No, less than 4 years.
It would really be helpful if they waived some part or all of the $500 setup fee. I understand it's labor intensive for them as well, but to get into New Hampshire, that's worth something to them, especially in a municipality. They've already gotten the file that they need from New Hampshire Retirement, so they're set and ready to go. They are talking to other municipalities in the state, but nobody's pulled the trigger yet. And I'm very displeased with who we have. It's just gotten worse and worse.
Their contract is 15 day out?
The contract we have now, yeah, was signed in 2013. And it just says, for cause, I believe we can give them 5 days written notice. I'm not going to try to prove cause. To just terminate, either party can terminate with 15 days written notice. So I would talk to her, figure out a good timing for us, and deliver that letter certified mail.
And this would be a multi-year contract?
A three-year.
Is it still built in for
each year? Yes, it has a municipal escape clause, because Massachusetts requires that as well, so any board could terminate I believe their contract is 30 days notice, but
so
I'm okay with that, because we couldn't move payroll in less than 30 days probably
but I'm just want to make sure that we're not binding future boards to a contract.
No, it has an escape clause. That's a requirement of all contracts in New Hampshire.
Okay. And they're competitive to what we have now, or less?
Yep. Yeah, we'll actually save, if we go with them, Michelle figured out July 1st, I think that's crazy soon. I was figuring out September 1st, but let's split the difference and call it August 1st. We'd save about somewhere between $1,000 and $1,200 this year. And that's even paying the $500 setup. And if I can get part of that wave, we do even better. They do our W-2s for us for less money. Like I said, they'll do the 1094 and the 1095, which Michelle has to do now. Mm-hmm. CheckMate doesn't even do it.
Which one's the 1095?
The Obamacare.
The Affordable Care Act one. Okay, gotcha.
That we have to do it. But we have to do it for all full-time employees, and these guys do it for us. And not only do they do it, but they take our payroll information, because we have to figure out full-time equivalents to see, what we have to report, and they'll do that for us, and we're like doing spreadsheets and trying to figure it out ourselves. So
they have it all at their fingertips right now.
Yeah, and they said that they can help us write so that we can import this directly into our general ledger, whereas right now Michelle has to do a manual journal entry for payroll every 2 weeks.
So they'll have
some kind of interface that will load a file and we'll just import it right into our GL, and it'll hit all the right accounts. Which is what I had in the last community I worked in. And it's just the less we have to touch it, the less chance there is that we transpose a number or code something to an incorrect GL. And, you know, it's not a big deal, but it's just one less thing we have to touch, so there's less chance for a manual error.
Good. Okay. Motion to accept. Motion to have allow the town administrator to pursue a deal with the new company, new payroll company.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you for your work on that.
Yeah, it's what you're paying me for. I'm done. Sorry, so many things.
It's all right. Building permit releases. Payroll warrant 12, $73,387.77. Motion to accept.
Second.
Everybody's looked through this?
Yep.
Yep.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Treasurer's warrant number 21 for $92.48 out of the Heritage Fund. Motion to accept.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Treasurer's warrant 22, $43,920.52. Motion to accept.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
There's just one question I have on that. What is that? Attorney? Spellman? Is that for?
Personnel matter.
Thank you.
Yeah, to exceed 5,000, I think.
Right.
So you guys asked under your work session last time that we write letters to Cindy, to Bob, and Gloria Belanger for their work, and then we have one done.
Okay, I'd like to read this one. Dear Lena, it is once again a pleasure to thank you for all you do for our community. You can always be counted on to help out, from Santa's breakfast of sponsoring a team to providing delicacies at town hall functions and retirement events. And in all your spare time, you somehow are able to juggle your responsibilities as both chair of the Board of Selectmen and as a state representative. Quite a balancing act, Lena. Thank you, Lena.
I am humbled. But I'm happy to do it on behalf of the town.
You don't have to sign this one.
No.
You look rather odd.
And we're going to copy it before we give it to you so that we have it for the file.
Hanging up on the wall, on the fridge. One was for to Mrs. Miss Belanger, thanking her for her service on the Parks and Rec Department, and Cindy DeBow, pleasure to thank you for all you do in our community, whether it's helping a neighbor, supporting an event, or hosting a fundraiser. You're always first in line to participate. Your generosity has been recognized by many, and it's evidenced by your having been voted Wakefield's 2018 Business of the Year. Congratulations. Thanks again, Cindy, for making helping to make Wakefield such a wonderful community. She's been around a lot of long time, and she's done some great things for us.
She has.
Wish her the best up there to continue on her.
Definitely know where you stand, Cindy.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sir. Minutes for May 9th. Right, motion to accept the minutes, public minutes for May 9th. As presented.
Second.
Any discussion or changes? All in favor?
Aye.
Abstain. Motion to accept as presented.
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
I don't have the paperclip, but each place you have to sign this tab.
Oh boy.
Puzzle putting them back together.
Oh boy, is right. Don't sign them on the first page. Great.
I
non-selectmen's work session.
I just got a couple things I want to say. On Pride Day out here, the officers, it was one of the officers that was out here that was actually took part in the getting jailed by the kids from the
house.
So they've, and also my daughter going to the Paul School said that they've been coming in, and so they're starting to see them and know them by first name. So I just wanted to say thank you to them for coming. Also is congratulating Lieutenant Waldron for his promotion to lieutenant. He's a good addition to the department, and he's a real squarely guy. So congratulations. That's all I have.
Non-publics to go back into after this? Any further discussion?
I make a motion, we adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you everyone for coming out. Thank you to the board for a nice meeting.